And now I've got two. Give him a call. He'll eventually answer. Hello? That didn't work. Huh. That was interesting. I answered that call and it immediately ended. Has handed off the emceeing duties to you. I guess we'll get you to talk about Skepticon while I play Mega Man. I don't know if you've been watching the stream, but I'm almost at the end of Mega Man 1, and I'm going to continue fighting my way through. So, can you hear me? Hello? Can you hear me? Having technical difficulties. I am not muted.
The delay of this is amazing.
The live stream is not going to be visible, really, to you. Unfortunately, I can't turn on the camera on the I can't turn on the camera on Skype at the same time. It eats up all my bandwidth, and then we lose our ability to actually upload and stream. I would recommend that we just talk for the moment. Your video is on the live stream, and there's about a 20-second delay, roughly.
Okay, there we go. I muted my the wrong computer. I have several of them right in front of me, and yeah. Oops.
I gotcha. Okay. So, like I was just saying, I am about at the end of Mega Man 1. I'm going to hand emceeing duties off to you, and you can feel free to talk about Skepticon for as long as you like. I'll try to stay engaged in the conversation. You are on camera, even though I can't show you my camera, because I'm sending that camera feed to the stream. Feel free to talk about whatever you'd like about Skepticon, about Lauren, how great she is, about me, how great I am for being on this stream. Whatever you'd like.
Sure. When it comes right down to it, I'm one of the newer people at Skepticon. I've only been there a few years as a attendee, and this is my first year actually getting in and helping out besides, you know, the manning of the table sort of thing.
Okay.
But I'm actually, until recently, I was a preacher. So it is a bit of a change, but it's Skepticon's really great. It's one of the first things that I did after I just gave up on religion in general, and I found a lot of people that were really nice and I wanted to be around, so I just kept coming.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. How long have you been involved in Skepticon? Just this year?
This is my third year attending, but the first year actually helping out and at the convention.
Okay.
Before then, I was one of the merry folk listening to talks and buying merchandise. Which, if you get the chance, you should really get the little cups with the logo on it. They're a great thing to collect.
Yeah, I've got a couple of those shot glasses myself. They're really nice. I like them a lot.
Yeah, I was really sad when a girlfriend and I both bought them, and in the process I lost mine. I'm like, oh man, I don't know if I broke it or if it was that, and then a friend broke one, and my collection was halved almost immediately, within a couple of days of each other. Sad.
That is kind of sad. That's awful.
But, so, when we come to Skepticon, one of the things I really appreciate about it is the, not only the diversity, because there's a lot of different people there, but also the care that everybody takes to make sure nobody is put out by it. When, like, even down to the name badges that have the red on them so people know that it prefer not to have your picture taken. That's the kind of thing that I really appreciated about them, because it's not like they were just saying that, you know, this is something we have to do. It's like, you know, we want people to be comfortable there. And I
actually put in the effort. Yeah,
the effort they put into it was kind of impressive to me for such a small operation, for as few people as were involved. So, it had to be something that I was going to try to help out with if I could.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, we've all come to skepticism from different paths, and we all kind of want to proselytize to the heathens, but at the same time, there's a lot of other issues, like other social justice issues involved in just getting people to the table. So that whole idea of taking care not to hurt people, taking care to honor their wishes with like the badges that have the different icons to indicate whether or not you should be photographed. That kind of thing is, those little touches make all the difference. I wish more places cared about that kind of thing. As far as I know, it's basically only Skepticon at the moment, which is, you know, it's good to be the vanguard, but at the same time, it'd be nice if more people cared about that kind of thing. And I don't know if that's actually the case that you're the only place that does, but you're the only place that I've seen that does, so.
Yeah. Well, I think it's, as time goes on, things are getting better everywhere, and even if other conferences aren't, the great thing about these kind of cons, and Skepticon, and all of them, really, is you see an idea you like at one, and you can replicate it really easy to another. So even if Skepticon is the first, which I don't know, like, but I kind of doubt it, but it's going to be everywhere before you know it, because ideas are just the best virus ever.
Yeah.
Depending on the idea.
They are good ideas, and they're easy ideas to export to other conferences. I should say that there have been a few that have done that kind of thing. Convergence has started doing the different colored lanyards and your preferred pronouns, stickers that show whether or not you're, like, if you have any kind of medical issues or anything like that. That is happening at other conventions now. Anti-harassment policies have become a thing over the last number of years as a result of issues that other conventions have had, and that idea is easily exported. I like all of the logistics behind all of that.
Yeah, that's a really great thing to see happening, because if when it comes right down to it, we're all just people trying to make it in the world, and if we can do a little thing like a colored lanyard or a colored tag on but his badge to make somebody more comfortable, that's really great, and that's one of the things that everybody at the team really tries to do, make people comfortable.
Yeah, this has actually had positive effects for some religious folks who were afraid that they might get seen being part of one of these conventions and has had the opportunity to participate and listen to talks, which is, it's not something that you'd normally think of for an atheist convention. It's really good to consider as part of outreach that somebody might be curious but not feel particularly free to engage otherwise.
Yep, very true. I know the first Skepticon I came to, I had not, my parents had no idea how I felt, and I was really not wanting them to find out from somebody else, because I had a pretty close family, and this is going to be a big deal for them. I think a lot of us have, you know, experiences kind of like that, where it's like, you know, just a little bit of a thought ahead of time can make a big difference to somebody. That is one of the great things about Skepticon. If people bring up ideas, like, you know, if it's something that can be done, I'm going to try to make it happen. And some things are just too big for the size of con that Skepticon is, but, you know, I'm going to try to accommodate everybody.
And I'm just dying repeatedly on the second run against Fireman in Mega Man 1. I don't know if you know the Mega Man games at all, but these things are brutal.
I have not played Mega Man in quite a while, but it was a part of my childhood. So, a confirmed geek. And I love PC gaming, board gaming, just in all sorts of ways. Doing things that make people give me weird looks.
Do things that make people give you weird looks.
Well, when you're going through carrying giant duffel bags full of games from one place to another, board games are not what people think about.
Right.
And back in the day when I was doing LAN parties with my friends, we'd play things like StarCraft. Carrying around a big tower PC, a big monitor, and just walking from room to room and seeing like 10 people do that, you got weird looks from the neighbors. They're like, what in the world are these people doing?
I will admit that I have been the LAN gamer in the past.
Yeah. The internet makes it so much nicer. Can socialize without the risk of breaking your computer or getting strange looks from the neighbor.
Now, I'm reloading my state repeatedly against the second Fireman because I am in a bad state. I can take exactly 3 hits, and there's a large element of randomness to this particular boss, which, if you saw on the stream, you'd be like, oh my god, I can't believe he's actually trying this over and over again with only 3 hits. this game doesn't have any energy tanks. You don't get a refill after these bosses. Future games are actually easier in this respect, even though Mega Man is really, really brutally hard all the way through. This is rough.
At this point,
I don't know if I'm actually going to get through it. I'm abusing saved states now for the first time since starting this game.
So, what are you using for playing it? Are you on a emulator?
Yes, I am. I'm using Mednafen. My entire setup right now is Ubuntu Linux using Open Broadcaster, sending it to twitch.tv. My controller is a Bluetooth Logitech F710. It looks kind of like a Xbox controller, which I have to admit is a little harder than regular controllers to play Nintendo games on. But I have unlimited lives on my games. I basically added the Game Genie code for unlimited lives to all of them to try to save some time. I'm hoping to get through three-ish games. We've got one person who's actually decided to fund us $25 per game that I get through. At this rate, I have not earned us a single dollar. Lauren says that somebody donated $100, which is nice, but I can't imagine that it's because of me in particular.
Believe in yourself. Believe.
I'm going to try something a little unorthodox. I'm going to save to a second state and see if I can get through Bomb Man without... without fire, which is his weakness. I'm going to try
I'm sure that you'll get it.
Eventually, maybe.
I think we all played these games so many times in a row just because we died once, so... That's why everybody is really good at the first stage of every level. It's because you had to play it 100 times before you could beat the second.
Right. I actually just beat Bomb Man without taking a hit, so I have a lot more than 3 hits that I can go after Fireman with. So that's good. But now I have one more boss to beat.
Good.
And I have been grinding at this since 10 o'clock. And I have not beaten the first game yet. Hooray me! I'll make it, though.
Oh. 55? Not bad.
What's that?
I said 55 deaths. That's not bad.
No, not horrible.
And you won. $12. Believe in yourself.
I can do it. I beat Elecman. Yay! I have just a shred of health. So, let's see what comes up next. What boss is this? Gutsman. Against whom I use bombs.
So, how long have you been attending... The Skepticons?
I have been there 4 years now? 3 years? This will be my 4th year. And this is going to be the first year that I'm doing any volunteering. I'm going to be the stage manager and miking the speakers as they come up. Which will be fun.
Yeah.
I'll get a chance to play with some high-end audio equipment, which I'm excited about.
Well... That's why everybody volunteers, isn't it? I have to admit, that is one of the things I like about my job, is being able to work with things and not break my own toys when something goes wrong.
Oh dear, this is starting to suck again. I've got exactly one hit to die right now, and I don't know if you remember Gutsman at all, but every time he jumps, you get shocked and can't move.
No. I started a little later in the Mega Man series than this. I think Mega Man 5 or 6 was the first one I played.
Okay. 6 was actually not developed by Capcom, which is kind of strange. It was like... Ah, I got him. Okay, sorry. It was developed by another company and distributed by Capcom, but it kind of seems as though it was like the last game for the console, and they just wanted to jam it out there before the console died.
I can't see that happening at all.
No, I know. Like, you'd expect that...
Well, I think everybody remembers the E.T. game, At the very least, you remember seeing pictures of it and being both delighted and appalled at the same time.
I have fond memories of E.T. as being... It was only really a bad game because it was buggy. There are actually... there's actually a bug fix of that E.T., where the hit detection isn't wacky, where you don't keep falling repeatedly into the pit, because it always lands you directly on the pit when you get out, where the difficulty levels are actually changed such that you can play with one, like just the scientists as your enemies, or just the FBI as your enemies, and the color. This is the most important thing. They changed the color of E.T. so that he's actually E.T. colored and not that puce green thing. You should check out that bug fix because it's actually kind of a fun play. It's fun to play a game as it was designed and intended to be played and not as the buggy thing that was actually released because they really wanted it to get out there for Christmas season.
I love that the fix came like 30 years after the game came out, though. That's just a little bit beautiful to me.
Definitely.
Because I think that came out in, what, 2013 or 2012?
Yeah, that sounds about right, yeah. So you've heard of it, you've seen this, I take it.
I have not played it, but yeah, I've heard of it. It is one of those games that my friends had. We had different games that we played, so it was really a game I played a lot to start with.
Okay.
So all the experience I had came later. I was one of the kids that got the consoles just before they quit making them, so... Uh-huh. But I had a friend that had all the new ones, so it was good.
Now, to my shame, I cheated for Yellow Devil using the Elec Beam and then pausing. And I could, in theory, beat Wily using the same strategy right now. But I don't know if I want to be a cheater. I mean,
you don't want to harm the integrity of the Mega Man Marathon?
No, exactly. It's important that it be high fidelity, true, that my morality be unimpeachable in this fight between robots and humans.
Yeah, you're right, that is very important. I wish I would have thought about that. That's morality of the coming robo apocalypse is something I guess I haven't given enough thought of.
Oh goodness!
At least in this, the robot apocalypse, the robots are on the side of humanity. So
some of them. Wily is going and turning these other robots evil and causing them to attack humans, whereas Rock, Mega Man, is, I guess, on the side of humanity by choice. He was given an actual morality. Mega Man has ended the evil domination of Dr. Wily and restored the world to peace. Hooray! And Lauren didn't get to witness it. She might be watching the stream now, though. That's good. So, she'll have seen me use save states all the way through. Fight Mega Man for everlasting peace. Now we're just gonna watch the end credits because I need a break. My hands are just like, I've got 5 more games to get through if I want to try to beat all the Nintendo ones. Oh boy.
Have you listened to Mega Ran?
I have not. What is that? Tell me about that.
Megaran is a He puts out songs that are just genuinely love tributes to most things geeky. He has one song called Splash Woman. Is the, as you can imagine, ballad of Mega Man and Splash Woman. It'll bring a digital tear to your eye. Only 8-bit though, so.
I should note that in the 80s, the credits largely for Mega Man, for Nintendo games, the credits largely had pseudonyms for all of the developers. Not because they weren't proud of their accomplishments, but so that companies would not have poaching happen between companies. And so this last credit was Yuki-chan's Papa, and that's really cute. I don't know who Yuki is, but I'm sure it's adorable.
I did not know that, but I love the idea of somebody walking around being called Papa in the office.
Yeah. Yuki-chan's Papa. So, the ballad of Mega Man and Splash Woman, Splash Woman being the only non-man gender-specified robot master in the official original series, though there were a number of female-presenting robots in the Mega Man X games. And there's also Roll, who is Rock's little sister, who is basically just waiting, hanging out at home, being, I guess, Dr. Light's maid or something. What a gender-progressive game series.
Well, this was back in the 80s. They were not exactly thinking about that sort of thing.
Right.
At least they're making progress today.
It's true.
A little slow, but still trying.
So I'm starting Mega Man 2. I am pleased to be able to say that I have just earned Skepticon $25 from our good friend in the Twitch chat, Alex. Thank you very much for that. I am hoping that I will jam through Mega Man 2 a lot quicker, since it is not as horrible a game.
To bring it back to Skepticon, that $25, that can actually do something, because as Lauren had mentioned, I believe, because I was listening for a little while before I had to jump out for a while earlier. But all of the money for Skepticon actually goes to the con, which really makes a pretty big difference when you're looking at, like, that $25 is going directly to renting the facility or getting different, even down to hand sanitizer, that kind of stuff that is going to be at the location that people are going to be able to use. So that $25 you just made is going to make somebody's weekend much better.
Yeah, definitely. What Lauren was saying about the free food for people who don't necessarily have the ability to eat out every day. All of those things make a difference in whether or not a person can actually consider the con a viable place to be. I'm really pleased. I was joking about the fact that I only made $25, but I'm really pleased that we've made it. That's really great.
Yeah, it should be. That's gonna make somebody's weekend.
Who was your favorite speaker in the last couple of years?
Oh,
kind of put you on the spot.
Names
here
are just what I'm really horrible with, and I could tell you what she talked about, but I don't remember her name. My favorite was actually a professor. I believe she was from University of Chicago, talking about a study that really gets me right here, because I came to where I am today purely from books and scientific papers, and it is just like validation of everything to see the actual scientists making efforts to try to figure this stuff out, because you know that's the only way it's going to happen.
Right.
And when you see different things about how different animals deal with the same kinds of things that we do, and the way they make the decisions, it's kind of hard to look at it immediately, but you know that there is something that you can learn from that, even if it's just, you know, don't be so hard on yourself. Because we're working with the same basic things they are.
Yeah.
Nobody gets mad at the rat. But the rat can be really nice sometimes.
I like the way you put that. It is sort of like a fundamental part of the human endeavor to constantly attempt to learn more about this universe, and sometimes people forget that there are sacrifices that have to be made for that information. And I would like to honor all of the rats who have died in the advancement of human knowledge.
Yeah. Well, no. For all of the studies that are done with rats, you know, many of them do die. But yeah, in the as the way things are looking right now, they have better medical options than we do.
That's
half
true.
Of the drugs that we test work on them and not us. So science is the never-ending quest to make a rat live forever.
You say that jokingly, and yet we know that that's absolutely true, that rats, we have the largest amount of knowledge about how they survive and how they, like, how to cure them of cancers, etc. And while we learn this for humanity's sake, the rats end up with a pretty decent life as a result, right?
Yep. Yep.
Maybe not the ones who die, but whatever. I'm awful.
It's a very strange situation when you know more about a different species than you do yourself. But
fighting Metal Man presently. I'm going to talk about ethics of having one robot murder another robot in the face repeatedly.
Well, and there's a third person watching, so am I the control, or what am I?
This is what happens when somebody doesn't murder somebody in the face with another robot.
When you don't take an arm cannon and shoot somebody, this is what happens.
Right.
Two, you beat the boss.
It's important to know what that's like. Not murdering robots. So that you understand the psychological effects of having me repeatedly murder robots.
I'm glad we're getting this down. It's
this is very silly.
Airman.
Yep.
All right.
I am at Airman with Metal Blades, and I was really hoping I could grab a thing of life before I kept moving, but they don't seem to be giving me any. Oh, the music in the stage, though. I love the music in the stage.
I'm not sure. Hear it.
Oh, are you having trouble with? Okay. Actually, that's something I have neglected to check into since starting this run, is whether or not people are able to hear okay. I realize that this is all kind of more art than science in some cases, but I'd like to try to make it an enjoyable experience for everybody. And I do apologize that I'm not 100% paying attention to you. Under normal circumstances, we'd be having a grand old conversation.
No, the stream is fine. I just have to switch to my other headphones to hear the stream.
Okay. That's good to know. Good to know. I'm moving along at a decent pace in Airman stage.
Getting wrenches thrown at you from the look of it. Or is that a fireball?
Lightning balls.
Lightning balls. Oh.
It's like... getting attacked by birds. Okay, from one egg hatches like 36 tiny birds. What is going on with that? How does robotics... Where did robotics go so wrong?
They're the rabbits of the robot world?
I guess, or something, I don't know.
From one rabbit will come an entire clutch full.
Oh no, I died! That's okay. I'm doing actually pretty well so far. I think that was my second death, and the first one was kind of on purpose because I wanted to get an energy tank before I had the item to be able to get it and then safely defer.
Gonna be zipping right through this particular one.
I'm going to try, at least, though I'm gonna keep dying. So do you have any particular skeptical topics that you want to hear at Skepticon? Is there any particular woo that you like making fun of over any other?
Right now I am pretty psyched about anything that is anti-vax. I see a lot of attacks against the fundamental way that we know about facts, and it just kind of makes me sad.
So, what you're saying basically is that the anti-vax movement don't actually know what they're talking about.
It's amazing how that works when you reject facts you don't have any. It's kind of weird, if you ask me. But yeah, it makes me sad because it's like some of the stuff that people... The Flat Earth Society has more members than it has had in its history. That makes me so sad.
That is damning of humanity. Ow.
I know, right? But those are the kind of things that I enjoy the most. I also have really taken a liking to some of the ones that talk about history. Being new to the whole skeptical scene, a lot of the things that people may take for granted is things that I haven't heard before, and I haven't had somebody say, hey, you should look this up. So it's like, those kind of things are always interesting to me, and everybody's like, oh, you don't know that? I'm like, well, no. You can either go into a big long spiel or just say, yeah, I haven't got around to it. So. But there is one of the speakers when I seen the schedule, I looked at her bio, and she, I definitely want to make sure I catch all of her talks, just because she was before she left religion, she was of the same group that I was, and she made a very different choice about she went about it. So I definitely wanted to hear her talks just to find out what brings two people that are doing the exact same thing to very different conclusions in different ways, but then finally doing the same thing.
It's funny, it's sort of like seeing the twin separation studies, where, which is unethical as all hell, taking two people with the exact same genetics and separating them out. It happens sometimes where people are actually adopted out, and then you can study them and find out whether or not there's a difference between them, and determine whether or not a particular aspect of personality might be more influenced by genetics than by background, things like that. It's always fun.
I have seen several of those, and I love it when they like reunite after a long time and they're wearing the same thing and stuff like that. It's like, it is a little bit sad to me to see that kind of thing, because it's like, well, maybe the decisions I'm making aren't quite as mine as I would think, but it's still really awesome. So, her name's Bridget Crutchfield.
Bria.
Oh, Bria. Yeah, that's her parentheses name, Bria.
Yeah. Sorry. I was wondering who it was you were talking about until just now. Okay, now it all comes together. All right.
I knew what her face looked like, but describing somebody's face is always a bad thing, because you're either going to describe it so awful no one's going to get it, or you're going to describe it even worse and you don't even know who you're talking about. So it's when I'm with a group of friends and I have another person I'm introducing, that is the worst feeling in the world. It's like, okay, you're not going to recognize a person from what I say, so why are we even pretending like I can explain this?
Why are we even talking at this point?
Pretty much. You'll see when they get here. But, yeah, I'm really looking forward to listening to her talk. And mostly because the experience is so different. But I really like hearing the different points of view from everybody. So it's like, I don't really dislike any of the talks. It's always something that, even if it's the talk in general, is something that I kind of have a handle on the subject, it's still interesting.
Yeah, definitely. I've learned quite a bit from quite a few people that I'd never heard before in past years, and I'm always pleased when I get to learn something that I'd never learned before, never known before.
Yeah, that's like one of the best things in the world. To me, it's like, I do not really understand people not being curious. I find so much what I really love comes from being curious.
Yeah, the human experience and all that. I keep going back to that, but I mean, that's kind of what this is all about, is talking about learning and loving learning.
Yep.
And I'm jamming through Crash Man stage now. I've already beaten Metal Man and Air Man. Oh, Mega Man 2 is so much better of a game already. It's just so much freer. It's so much better designed. I'm waxing ecstatic over this, because this is the game that got me into the Mega Man games. Number 2.
Well, we all have our favorite games in a series. have you played Civilization much?
Oh dear me, yes.
Yeah.
Civ 3 was my poison in university. And I say that knowing full well that dates me.
Well, I played Civ 1, so, you know, it hadn't just come out, but I remember when Civilization 2 Call to Power came out, being really excited about that.
Yeah, so it dates you too.
Yeah, it does. It's, on one level, it doesn't bother me at all because it was so awesome. But on the other level, it's like, oh, what has happened? The kids today, they'll never know what it's like.
Oh, dear me. So hard being an old fogey like us. I'm 37, so I don't know what that puts you at.
34. So, I'm not too far behind.
Oh, goodness gracious me. I could go down and get that energy tank and then have to backtrack. I already have two. I'm good for a bit. Though, you can't re-traverse the levels in Mega Man 2. I don't believe you can re-enter a level. So, if I want that, I need it. I gotta get it. And I'll drop.
So, you know, one of the things I remember growing up is sitting in front of my computer, or actually at the time it was barely a computer. Nice Tandy 2000.
Oh, my first computer was a Tandy 1000EX.
Really?
Yeah, we were both Tandy kids. That's great.
Yeah, my first and second computers were both Tandys.
Cool. The 2000 was the one with the 3.5-inch disc, wasn't it?
Yes. It had the 5.25 that was built into the system. It had It had the optional disk drive off to the side. And I remember taking some of my friends over to see it and bragging about the disk without taking it out.
Boom.
But yeah. Even though I didn't have glasses, they would have been really, really thick. Super nerdy.
Nerddom is good.
I have found it has been helpful to me. I'm making my living off nerddom now, so I'm not going to complain.
Yeah, me too. I'm a computer nerd, so that's my profession.
Yep, that's... And how I got started into my profession was just doing it for, like, I wrote my first program when I was kind of for fun. Yeah, I got one of those little booklets that was writing. It was Visual Basic and, you know, all sorts of just ridiculous stuff like that. And then not being able to stop myself. Yeah, okay.
Stop.
Okay, there was two different models of the Tandy 2000. The one had the 5.25 and had two of them. Another had a single 5.25. And if I'm looking at this correctly, there was also one that had the 3 built into the system. So,
okay.
I guess I had the poor man's Tandy 2000. The single 5.25.
I recall the Tandy 1000EX as only having the one 5.25 drive. I think there was an expansion bay that you could attach one externally, but it had to be external. It wasn't part of the real thing. I didn't have a modem. I didn't have... basically, I only had the bare bones, and I only had 256 megs of RAM, which... No, 256K of RAM, sorry.
I was going to say, I think that might be a little bit big.
Yeah. I specifically remember having the 256K because of all of the Sierra games, the adventure games, when they came out with Gold Rush, I wasn't able to play it because it required 512.
Yeah. That was always the fear when you got the games that came on more than one disc.
Yup.
And like, oh no, is it gonna crash?
I just jammed my way through Crash Man pretty quickly. And now I'm at Bubble Man. First time I saw the background on Bubble Man with the scrolling waterfall, I thought this was the best graphics I'd ever seen in my entire life.
Yeah. I think it was... it might have been a Dungeons and Dragons game for the Super Nintendo that I remember... my cousin just going on and on, like, look how many different depth fields there are. Oh my god.
Yeah, the depth fields, yeah.
Yeah. It it ran in my family.
My sister and I were both pretty nerdy, but I was significantly nerdier than my little sis. I'm sorry, sis. Sorry, not sorry. I was the one who was making QBasic games on my Tandy 1000BX.
Yeah. I didn't start trying to make my game until we had upgraded to a different Tandy. I forget what it was, but it had a CD-ROM drive.
Oh my goodness, high tech.
Fuck. Oh, yeah. And it took us weeks to get that stupid thing to work because there was, like, some sort of I.O. fault in it, or a UI fault. God, it's been so long since I had to deal with those. I think they were QI faults. Basically, the internal port mapping was wrong.
Oh, IRQ.
IRQ, yeah. Ah.
Interrupt request. Oh no, I just died. I just had an interrupt request of a spike to the brain.
Yeah.
I jumped too high in Bubble Man's stage. And there's spikes along the ceiling. Ah, good times. Ah, I remember these games so fondly.
Yeah.
That's brutal.
When these games first came out, this was like an entire weekend.
Yep.
Then from the shop down the road, video rental place.
Yep. I did mine as rentals too.
Oh yeah.
That was the way.
We're made out of money.
Can't afford $40 for a full game. Not in this economy.
Right.
So you'd rent it for $3 down at the corner store and have it for the weekend. And if you were lucky,
stayed up till 4 in the morning.
Stayed up till 4 in the morning. I had friends over and we did sleepovers and the game rentals. Took my entire allowance to do it. We did it. Ah, good old days.
Yeah. This was back before freemium, kids! You know what I love to see, though, is the some of the younger kids are playing these systems and games very retro, but loving them so much.
Yeah,
it makes me really happy.
It's kind of a nostalgia to see somebody else experience the game that you loved for the first time.
Yep.
Kind of feel the same way about, like, Undertale. Games like that.
I have an N64, and I love bringing people to, like, if I have a party, a couple of people will be off doing something. I'm like, hey, have you guys played Mario Kart?
Nice.
Anybody my age gets super excited right then, but everybody else is like, oh, you'll be excited. As you can tell, the parties in my house are just off the hook.
off the chain, yo.
Yep, one second.
Sure.
Oh, that's worse. Yeah, that's worse.
Oh, the lighting. I see.
Yeah. The clouds came out and I looked down and I couldn't see my face. I was like, oh, well, that's not good for a live stream.
Turning
the light made it worse, so.
It's all good. I can see you just fine, and I mean, there's lots of things to look at on this stream, so. I just defeated Bubble Man, and my cat decided to come over and lay on the computer that I'm using to do my live death count, and I'm not sure whether or not he actually hit the keys or not. If he walked across that, it would have increased my death count significantly. That would have been hilarious.
Well, it didn't jump much if it did. I was looking the other way, but...
that's okay, though.
That's what cats are good for.
Right.
I know, when I was still doing... every once in a while, I would be chatting with the customer or something, and my cat would hop on the keyboard. Right on the keyboard. It's like, oh, you think I'm an idiot. Thank you. You want to starve to death with me, don't you?
Clearly.
Seem to care.
Oh, I love the music in this stage. I'm in Heatman stage now. The music in this game, top-notch. For the Nintendo, every theme has this sense of shit just got serious. Every single song. There's not a single bad track in the soundtrack. If this was released today, there would almost certainly be a soundtrack premium purchase of some sort.
Yeah. I love video game music, actually. It kind of damns me just a little bit more, but if you've ever listened to Skyrim's music, that is really great music.
Oh yeah, definitely. The songs in it are phenomenal. Not to mention the actual Skyrim theme that is full of chanting and stuff. And I love chanting in video game music. Going back as far as Final Fantasy VII and the Sephiroth themes during the last boss of Final Fantasy VII, it was... Oh, I'm getting all... choked up over it.
Yeah. That, there's a reason the religion uses it. It's highly effective.
Oh, yeah.
And nobody don't like no chanting.
Nobody doesn't like chanting. It's true. It has a bunch of known, quantifiable psychological effects. So.
Yeah, that is something that I found really interesting. The effect of people's chanting it basically, and the susceptibility to via implantation. There's some really, really neat papers out there on that for my own reasons I read through like a madman. But super interesting. And then when you play all these games and you're like, oh, that's that thing that I did with the thing. Yeah. It wasn't an accident that I love this.
Guess where I am in Heatman stage. I'm at the blocks. The disappearing, reappearing blocks. people over a fire pit. With instant death.
This is where I always gave up half my lives.
Well, I have unlimited lives, so that's good. The only problem is, I don't have unlimited time. I'm already failing before I've even hit the fire pit part, so I'm doing well. Doing pretty well here.
Believe in yourself.
Unfortunately, I don't have the rush jet to skip over this. I've got item number two. Oh, number two is the jet. Okay. Screw you guys. I'm out of here. Sorry. I just... Just that moment. That moment of triumph.
Yeah, well, not gonna lie. I heard Cartman when he said that.
Screw you guys, I'm out of here.
I'm going home.
Yep. I'm not quite as awful as Cartman.
Well, I think he is one of the better characters in... TV, just because you can say the most awful stuff like that, and then it makes people actually realize how horrible it is. Like, this is where I diverge with a lot of people. Mm. I think showing people how ridiculous they are is really helpful.
Yeah, I can see that. I feel like, though, I don't know, I'm always of two minds of this kind of thing. Like, I understand the satire factor, Stephen Colbert, for instance. Like,
yeah.
I get that some people will find that to be particularly helpful to them in processing a bad situation. But at the same time, when I see something like South Park that normalizes repeatedly talking about Jews as... in a prejudiced way, then you get the 4chan culture that are doing the exact same thing. Like, everybody, the 4chaners who are supporting Donald Trump right now, they're basically Eric Cartman. Hundreds of them. And they're doing this kind of thing to real people on the internet all the time. And I can't help but fault, like, this is... South Park's fault in a lot of ways.
See, and I see where you're coming from with that, but I think when normal people see that, normal people see just how vile an attitude is. I think the average person is a relatively good person, and when they see that kind of just unconscionable attitude that some people have, I think they see it for that.
And I hope so.
And the reason I say that is because different things like that, especially comedy, is, as weird as it sounds, one of the things that made me start to really question what I was doing. Because it's like, you can... It gives you that opportunity to laugh at yourself. Not a whole lot of things can really do that.
Yeah, I see, and that's a pretty good argument.
And it's just, maybe it is because it is related to my story, but it is something that in society as a whole does more harm than good, or more good than harm. Because you're always going to have awful people. But I think when a normal person just sees how awful people can be, they'll want to distance themselves from it.
I'd hope. I mean, generally I'd hope that they would.
Yeah, I hope so too. But I am a bit of an optimist, so I may not be correct about that.
I don't know. You get a lot of comedians who think that being edgy is to punch at people who are already being hurt.
Yeah.
That's edginess. That's rather right. than being a status quo warrior. Like, people complain about social justice warriors, but the people who fight for the status quo when the status quo is plainly harmful to some folks, I think that's a more damning thing. I don't know.
Yeah, I would agree. That kind of a edginess isn't really edginess. And so I totally am there with you on that.
Well, I'm a social justice warrior. What do I know? not really warrior, though. Mage, maybe? I don't know. I like to stay in the back and help other people. Maybe I'm like a buffer.
You're the confirmed supporter.
Yeah.
You're backup. That's kind of how I see myself, too. I used to give lots of public talks and lots of I was the person that I now think is ridiculous and laugh at openly.
Okay.
I think that even those people, I wasn't like the the racist or anything like that. I was just the person who's like, oh no, God did it because God.
Because you were a preacher at one point, you said?
Sorry?
You were a preacher at one point?
Yes, I was.
Tell us a bit about that, because I'd like to hear the stories about how you got into being a preacher.
I was a Jehovah's Witness, and they don't call them preachers. They call them elders, but...
Okay, elders.
It's the same thing for everybody else.
So you're my junior right now, but you were an elder at one point.
sorry?
I said, you're my junior right now, but you were an elder at one point.
Exactly. Basically, I was doing it because everybody I trusted said, yeah, this is what you do. This is how you help people. You teach them God and make sure that they don't die. I'm like, okay, that's how I help people. And that's when I was a teenager, and then life kind of happened, and I got married, I had a business, I had all these things that kept me busy, and I never took the time to look at the things that I thought were, that eventually actually made me leave religion in general. I just didn't do it because I didn't have time, as ridiculous as that sounds, just life. But, after a while, something just kind of slapped me in the face, and I was like, oh, I'm going to have to take a look at this. And the most ridiculous thing ever, it was similarities in between Moses and Horus, which wasn't even a big deal for me, but that made me look at some other stuff that actually became a big deal.
Huh. Okay. For me, it was something along the lines of, I was pretty sure that all of the people around me must have had some reason for being super religious, that there must have been something to it, because otherwise there was just a lot of people who were not even thinking about that major part of their life. They're not really considering that there might have been something not right about what they were proselytizing to kids. I'm sort of splitting my concentration here, and if I really want to talk, I should be pausing the game.
I totally agree with you. That is part of the reason that I had, when I was a teenager, just decided, you know what? My parents, my grandparents, all these people probably do know what they're talking about. I totally understand what you're saying there, because I think that's, when you're a teenager, that's kind of what you do. You just, depending on, you know, how you were raised, you're either going to, you know, start thinking for yourself and try to make the best decision you can, or in other social norms, you just follow along with the crowd because that's what you're expected to do.
Right. Yeah, I grew up French Catholic, and I was telling Lauren this a while ago, and I might as well recap. It's a very, very much fixated on the saints and stuff like that. So it's very, it's like that pantheistic monotheism. I was confirmed, I was baptized, I was circumcised, I got the whole religious treatment all the way through, before I realized at around 13 that a lot of people were saying a lot of things about this entity that I didn't really see any proof of, and I wasn't really sure what was going on with the whole Bible thing. So I read the King James Bible, and it certainly wasn't the Shakespeare that I was reading. And yes, I was reading Shakespeare at 13. Not to brag or anything, I didn't get most of the Shakespeare that I was reading, but I liked the idea that I could be smart enough to read and kind of get what's going on in Shakespeare, and so I decided to take a stab at the Bible, and no, I read it 2.5 times over, and I didn't, none of it seemed to make really a lot of sense to me. It was talking a lot of fantasy. It felt a lot like a really old fantasy book, like somebody's fan fiction about some super dude named God. It didn't really grab me the way that Lord of the Rings did. So let's say. You okay?
Yes. I knocked something off my desk.
Ah.
Playing with the cord. I fidget with stuff. Yeah. No. 13, I wish I would have gotten it that soon. I was quite a bit older. I was almost 30.
Wow.
So, yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, it, and the Jehovah's Witnesses, they have, like, basically a, their shunning policy is a lot stricter than most.
Okay.
So, I think that's part of the reason that I put it off as long as I did, so.
Because you didn't want to be shunned? Or...
Yeah, and eventually it just got to the point where it was, like, guilt over lying to people, and my unwillingness to become thing that I really hated just got the better of me.
Huh. Okay.
But, you know, there's, I have a lot of respect for people that do that. I will talk to hear about people that did that as a teenager. When I did it, I had a good career, I had a house, I had all the stuff an adult needs. I already had those things, and to make that same decision without all of that has got to be the scariest thing in the world. But these kids that do this at such a young age, I have so much respect for. Not only are they just figuring stuff out sooner, but it's like you're willing to throw it all in.
Oh, goodness. I'm fighting... what's his name? Flashman, who doesn't flash you. He freezes time.
Ah, okay. I didn't think that was a trench coat, but I don't know, graphics are...
barely pulled that one out. Okay, so I beat Flashman. Hooray! He'll flash nobody any longer.
I love the names of these guys.
Yeah, I was telling Lauren a while ago about how at a certain point they start looking through the thesaurus for synonyms for fire and ice. They just, I don't know, heat, spark, flame.
Emberman.
Yes. And then six, they just go completely off the rails and start doing Yamato Man, which is not a character that anybody who's not Japanese will understand what the heck is going on with him.
He's... Isn't that a surname?
Yamato?
Yeah.
I think so. It's also... apparently it's a cultural thing in Japan that represents traditional culture. Yeah, like traditional Japanese culture. And so you'll see the word Yamato pop up in a lot of places. I don't really understand all of the circumstances under which it shows up, but in this game, he's just this guy with a spear. It's like,
so he's fighting traditional?
I guess. I don't know. I really couldn't tell you. I guess so. Let's say yes. So I beat Flashman, and I'm on to the final boss of the first Robot Masters in Mega Man 2. Oh god, I'm gonna die. Quick Man, who does a whole lot of laser beams that are instant death. Thankfully, I've got unlimited lives still.
You have to get to the bottom before those things close the way.
Yep, that's the one.
Watching the live stream a little bit behind, but...
Yeah, it's about 10-15 seconds late. Oh, crap. I picked the wrong way. I forget which way I'm supposed to go here. Oh, I died. Hey, that's my first death in a while.
Yep.
Oh, you're doing pretty good.
I think your death counter is either froze or you didn't tap it a couple of times.
Oh, well, I could throw on a couple more deaths as a buffer. It seems to be working. I've got this little script that I put together that increments a number every time I press a key on the keyboard and then outputs the results to a text file, and my stream can pull in text files. Oh, I shouldn't have been talking there. I should have actually been paying attention. Let's throw another one.
I'm just trying to see if we can get to 128 or 256 before this is over.
Before 2 is over, yeah. Get a good base 2 number going.
Exactly. I prefer base 8, but, you know, I'll take what I can get.
And I can't slide in this, or this would be a lot easier. Ha ha! I'm not gonna make this one. Ha ha ha! These are hard. These are very hard. This game. This game. You guys. All of them are really hard, but this particular spot is that one level that you'll never get through. I remember as a kid replaying, doing the continues over and over again on that. I died because I couldn't jump correctly.
Yeah. Yep, that's, that was childhood.
That was childhood. Now, I could abuse save states. I did do a bit of save state abuse in the last game, mostly to get through those two areas that are impossible to get through without some form of cheating, being the second robot bosses. Oh, let me load that so I don't have to fight through that first screen again.
Now, when you were playing as a kid, did you have the controllers that would auto-fire for you?
I did not have an NES Advantage, no. Oof. That hurts. That hurts so bad. Mm. I should be adding some more deaths to the counter.
I remember having very serious conversation with some of my friends as to whether or not that was cheating.
The save states?
No, the controller with the auto fire when they finally came out. Is that? I don't know.
It's a little bit.
Depends on what game it is.
Yeah, definitely.
And now I have keyboards with pre-programmed key combinations on them. So, apparently I don't think it's cheating. Because who wants to hit Control-Alt-F or something?
Uh-huh. I should be saving between screens. Really? No, I shouldn't be. That's awful. I care more about the fidelity of my gameplay experience than anybody else here does, really. This is important to me. I need to do it. I wish I could slide, though.
The bad thing about playing a game that you've played sequels to? Like, man, I really wish I had this. Like, won't be available for another two games.
Right.
Playing Mario 1 and wishing that you could get the raccoon suit.
Or the bee suit that you get in the later Mario games. I'm way too far. I'm not gonna make it. I'm gonna add a bunch of deaths to that. I'm not sure how many, but I'm sure I died a bunch. This game is Nintendo hard. I'm gonna try going down the other
side. Four or five times you play it, you think it literally cannot be beaten.
Yeah.
It's like, ah, they've done it again! So, this year at Skepticon, going to be quite a few, I don't know if anybody has, how many people watching the stream have been to Skepticon before. Going to be a few extra things. I think Lauren probably talked about them, but they're trying to get to it. Some of them haven't been talked about publicly yet, which, because the plans aren't final, may not. But it's, if you're on the edge before, you should probably come again, because there might be some really great things. Very fluffy. Sorry?
Is it stuff you can talk about, or are you just going to tease us?
Oh, well, they're trying to get animals, fluffy, tiny animals. If that can
fluffy,
happen.
Tiny animals.
I know, right?
Aww.
Yeah, if that works out, I'm going to be the happiest person there because I'm that guy that posts Facebook pictures of cats because I really love cats and, you know, get the, one of the, in the Skepticon chat, one of the my favorite things is the, FX is, I don't know how many other people will jump to the Skepticon chat just to see that. I do. Just, I love it. It's like, when, the fact was that a cat was mayor in a city in Alaska for the last, I believe it was 15 years. That's awesome. It's like, just want to high-five everybody in that tiny city. And
that is pretty cool.
Who doesn't want a cat for mayor? Your mayor's may well be just obtuse towards your feelings and want to kill small things anyway, so you might as well be able to put it in a cat carrier when it's being really mean and attacking you, or let it go outside and kill rodents. Which is where my cat is right now. She came up to the window earlier and was trying to convince me I needed to let her in. But if I do that, every button on my keyboard will be pressed again.
That's adorable. I've got a cat here who keeps reaching over for my laptop that has the death counter, and I really wish that he would just, you know, press it for me so that I wouldn't keep forgetting and having to throw on five at a time like I did just now.
Which is kind of funny, considering how much cats really seem like they want to kill you.
Yeah, you should be helping count how many times I die.
Yeah.
This cat's a grumpy bugger. He's got his tongue stuck out right now, and it's adorable. Can't quite get him on camera.
I got a one-eyed cat that I named Patch, and she tries to kill absolutely everything. I wear shorts that tassels, and it took forever to figure out that that's why she was attacking me. For like, she would just randomly assault me. Couldn't figure out why. Apparently because I make a great toy. Better than all of the numerous dollars worth of cat toys I have strewn about my living room.
Obviously, you are the best, most viable human target in the area, is why.
Apparently she thinks she can eat me. Shouldn't have got her little tiny cat-sized condiments. It's going to be great with A1.
When our cat overlords, you know, own the world, we are their slaves. Oh wait, that's already how it is now.
Yeah. That is true.
I am at Wily, stage 1, and it has the best theme in all of Mega Man. In every single Mega Man, this theme is my favorite. I have a heavy metal version of it as my ringtone. I had it for quite a while. But this is what I think of when I think of the music in Mega Man, is this theme specifically. I have so many parts of Mega Man 2 etched into my brain.
Yeah, I had the tone for a very long time. I still go back to it sometimes. And my message tone was
Hey, listen!
Oh god, just because.
Yeah. Just because, why not? It made me happy. Oh, boo.
I'm gonna have to go back over here. They actually give you one of those little dudes that spits the worms so that you can recover your weapon energy, which is good because you are absolutely required to use one of your special weapons, one of your special items, to get through this little area. And for the life of me, I am not getting the timing right on the jump.
Ah.
There we go. Okay, I'm through that little area. That's awesome. So I plan on being at Skepticon on the Thursday prior to the con. Hopefully Thursday early evening, at which point I will get trained up on how to do the miking of people, but I assume there will be some time for hanging out and chatting generally. That would be nice.
Yeah. That's what staying up till 3 in the morning is for, after everything's finished.
Sure, that's... I'm old, though.
Yeah. It's still... one of the, Close. I take vacation days for Skepticon so that I can get feeling like I'm going to die by the time it's over. The first year, and that was a mistake.
Yeah, I probably should be taking vacation days after Skepticon too, but I have quite a few cons that are kind of bunched up together. In advance of that, I'm actually going to be taking some vacation days specifically so that I can visit my sister in Nova Scotia, who is getting married. And so, unfortunately, I'm kind of stuck with... Oh no, I died. I'm kind of stuck with a limited set of vacation days that I have available to me. October is a pretty busy month for me.
Well, if the choice is being at your sister's, way day off. Yeah, it's not really a choice.
No, not if I'm going to be your best man. I should maybe be there. Maybe.
If you ever want to be invited to family gatherings again.
Yeah, exactly. Oh dear, I don't have enough weapon energy, number one energy, to actually get through that area. I'm gonna have to backtrack a bit and grind some energy. Okay. This sucks. Ah, Nintendo games! I'm having fun!
Yeah. This is what they did, though, is they made you do the same thing over and over again in different ways, and then have to backtrack. And somehow it was always a game that you looked forward to.
Mm-hmm.
If a game today did this, I would be not nearly as happy with it. But there's something about these games. They could just get away with it.
I don't know. There's a lot of grinding in more modern games, too, like the World of Warcraft type stuff.
I do not play World of Warcraft or any MMO for that reason, though, so that just drives me a little bit batty.
Yeah, I get that. Okay, so I need more weapon 1 energy. Some of the later games were a little bit better about energy management. You get a balancer that would automatically put the energy tank where it needs to be into the weapon, the special weapon that is least charged. and you also get, like, an ability to store an energy tank for later. Right now I've got 4 energy tanks, but they're not weapon energy tanks, they're for my life bar. I really wish that I was in one of those right now, except for the fact that this is my favorite of them, so I don't really wish that I was in one of those.
I'm super lazy when it comes to games. I really love the way Mass Effect 1 did weapons energy. A non-issue.
Oh, auto-recharging?
Yeah,
I agree. There are some modern conventions like the self-recharging health bar that I'm not a huge fan of. Depends on the game, though. Like, having to go and grind for weapon tank energy is not fun, regardless. And if the game designer is trying for a balance of difficulty and fun, and they're not erring on the side of fun, then I'm not a big fan of the get-good type gamers that are like, well, we should just stop sucking so much. Like, if it's not fun, it's not fun.
Right, yeah.
It's not about my ego, it's about having fun while doing this thing. I'd rather have fun.
Right, if I want to do something that I disliked just to get it over with, I have a feeling that my kitchen would be cleaner than it really is.
Right? Like, chores that make a difference in your life.
Exactly.
Not grinding for energy tanks in Mega Man.
Well, you have to admit, though, these didn't have a whole lot of new ideas to choose from. Were making it up as they went.
That's true.
So, a lot of the things that we like about the games we play now were kind of because of these games.
They were the vanguards. First out of the gate. Okay, now I'm about to take on the dragon boss that I have to use the quick boomerangs on, and I've got to really concentrate. If you want to fill dead air, by all means, please do.
Okay. So, speaking of things that isn't a grind, if sitting and listening to talks at a con is not your thing the entire time, there is plenty of workshops, and there's some schedules on the Skepticon website of different workshops that you can, while you're at the con, if something other than listening to a speaker is a weekend. And let me bring up the list. Oh, gosh. Two computers keep typing in the wrong one.
Yep.
This is why at work I just tie everything into one computer, because this drives me crazy.
No, I get that.
It makes a really fun chain of being seen to this machine, to that machine, because you forget that you're in machine 2, and it's like, oh, boo. I was meaning to do that from the machine I'm actually sitting at. And, oh, we need to do that. We don't have the workshop schedule up for... Ooh. And I don't want to share the document that's there. Well, I've seen a list of the workshops that we're going to have available, and there's going to be some pretty interesting ones. In the past, there's usually two or three a day, and three areas that they're going to be in here, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. What?
Sorry.
We've heard about two of the workshops at least. One of them being on polyamory, the other one being on art. I suspect that Lauren might have talked about other ones, but I can't remember them. I'm sorry, Lauren.
Is much more involved in setting those things up than I am. I am just sitting off to the side, very happy that I don't have to organize all of that, because that is a lot of work that they go through to make sure that they have workshops that are not only interesting, because let's face it, some topics we just don't care about. Like these ones that a lot of people may be kind of curious about, like the polyamory workshop. I really didn't know a whole lot about, so I was kind of interested. I had a friend that is, and I was like, well, okay, I didn't know what that's about, but I don't want to be rude and just start asking all these super personal questions of somebody that... I feel more comfortable learning something like this from a workshop like that.
Yeah. That
makes sense. Makes it okay to ask stupid questions. Maybe not insult your friend. And that's what the con is about. Not insulting
your friends. Yeah. Totally. That's why I'm here.
So, you are... just getting into the main dungeon?
I am presently, for the first time, at Wily level 2, I think? Yeah. Wily 2. I have enough crash energy to get through this, but then I think the boss requires crash energy, so I shouldn't be using these. So I'm gonna have to find a place to grind some energy. Maybe. No, maybe not. Lucky. Managed to pick up a couple of energy from those walls. There's an extra life there that I missed.
You got to love Nintendo games. Energy, destroy a wall. Run out of money, destroy a clay pot, you know.
Yeah. Just some senseless vandalism is usually the answer.
Exactly. My 80s kids were so destructive. Gosh. We were just looking for rupees.
Yeah. Oh, no. I died.
Oh well. Okay, so, trying to find one of the, Megaran, there we go. Actually, this would probably be under copyright, so Twitch would probably not like it.
Most likely not, unfortunately.
Okay, well, that was a sad idea.
They sort of cast a blind eye to the fact that you're playing copyrighted video games, but I don't know.
They just got into a bunch of trouble with people using copyrighted works. What was it, like 6 months ago? No. That is kind of the a little bit of a a little bit of a funny angle to the entire YouTube and Twitch. It's like, well, yeah, no, it's not, but kinda. Especially when looking at with all of the different corporations trying to lock down their intellectual property. Like, they just go way overboard, so it makes it hard to know what is legitimate and what isn't.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of self-defeating, though, too, because, I mean, who is going to see Mega Man on a Twitch stream and not want to play it themselves in order to actually experience the game that they're witnessing? Mega Man is one of those games that its point is not to watch the game play to beginning to end. Its point is to actually go through these grueling trials yourself. And if you're not doing it, if you're just watching somebody else stream it, you're missing the point, right?
Well, I think anybody who had an older sibling playing games knows what it's like to sit there and watch someone play video games for hours.
Yeah.
And you have a little bit of that nostalgia for that, too.
As the older sibling who has subjected my poor little sister to watching me play Mega Man for hours, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, when you're the younger sibling, watching is, and then sometimes being able to be Luigi, you know, the important things.
Right. And I believe I have a little area full of drill things that I can grind some weapon energy here.
Watching the stream, and I should be talking.
That's okay. No, I appreciate somebody actually enjoying watching this game, but at the same time, like I said, you're not playing it yourself, you're a loser. I'm sorry. It's cruel.
So, when you got these games as a kid, did you have your friends over and play them? Or you would take turns at the controller? No, you did the last level! Let me have it!
Yeah, I think that was a thing that would have happened quite frequently, yes.
That is, I think, one of the three great things about growing up in the 80s. Video games went through a period when they were very social and very antisocial. And now they're getting social again. It's nice. To me. And, back to the way I remember games being.
Yeah, the couch games phenomenon kind of dissipated for a while and then came back. And it is nice. It is nice to see that cooperative games are coming back. Most part, the games that are cooperative are games like, you know, World of Warcraft or things like that, that you're raiding together. But, and that's not really my thing. I'm more the solo player for RPGs. But at the same time, I love having somebody there to be the second set of eyes just in case we miss something. Or, you know, somebody to trade off to who knows the game mechanics that you can walk away for half an hour and let them do it.
That's what a guild's for.
Yeah. Yeah. But you have to get really good guild members.
Yeah. I had to step away from that kind of stuff because for a while I was really into it. Started spending all of my time And then once I kind of backed away from it, I wasn't able to get back into it. It, I don't know, just, it's also about the time that I started taking up board gaming with several groups here locally.
Okay.
So it kind of took up that spot. Oh, doing lots of MMOs is not as appealing to me as it once was.
Oh, this is fun. I'm having fun right now. Yay, wee.
Oof. Don't stop telling yourself.
Don't stop believing. Sorry.
It is a journey. Or is that the... Ah. I'm so awful when it comes to music titles. Just about as awful as I am with names is a little embarrassing.
Now, I wasn't singing it very well, so I could totally understand somebody not getting that that's Journey.
I unfortunately have that very common situation when I'm meeting somebody, it's like, yeah, I know your face, I know what we talked about, but I have no idea what your name is. And it makes me feel really awful, like a horrible human being, when they remember mine. I'm like, oh, boo. Like, I know what we talked about? Does that help? It doesn't.
Oh, boy. This is fun. I'm having fun. I'm playing a video game.
You're one stage away from being done with it.
It's true. It's true. I have jammed through Mega Man 2 at a significantly faster rate than Mega Man 1. Well, that's because Mega Man 1 is really a kind of stinky game.
It's, best quality was that it led to further Mega Man games?
Pretty much. A lot of the mechanics were there, but the specifics, like the precision of the jumps and stuff, they were just lacking. They weren't up to snuff compared to the further games.
Well, there is a lot of games that were like that. You play as a kid and you're just like, there's something about it being your first video game that makes it that much more exciting, and you're willing to overlook the stuff that after you've played a few more you're just really not going to. And then you go backwards and start playing something like Candy Crush.
There's nothing wrong with a casual game like Candy Crush. There's nothing wrong with that at all. That's a game.
No. I've went backwards from being like the... It's like, no, that's not a real game to... Well, Candy Crush isn't bad. I'll play it.
Yeah. If it's something that you're willing to spend time on that isn't, I guess, necessary, that isn't, you know, your job, then it's a game. Even if it's grindy. Even if it's like... say one of the Sims games where you're just making a person repeatedly go to the bathroom and then wash their hands 100 times in order to get their hygiene meter up. Instead of, you know, taking a shower, they just wash their hands 15 times. That's fine. That's a game.
Yep. That is true. That is true. We're making them work on their charisma just so you can hear them say, "It's frost finishing," over and over.
Wow.
You can tell what I did. I thought it was hilarious.
Yeah. But I mean, as children, we were not particularly the most mature. I assume that you were as immature as I am. That 12-year-old me playing Lara Croft Tomb Raider making her use a med kit over and over again because it kind of sounded like she was moaning. It was awful. I was awful. I'm not proud of those days, but...
I have to say, I did not play any Lara Croft games. I'm still not sure I've played one. So... That does not sound too far off from something I would do, because teenage boys are horrible, horrible creatures. But I do appreciate not being one so much more. It's like, oh, I can be an actual human being now. Thank you.
Right. I'm almost there. This is the final home stretch. No, wait. That's wrong. Now that I need crash bombs, I have a full complement of crash bombs. I have to conserve them through this level. Oh boy.
That is getting really close. Are you going to have to grind through all of the bosses you did on the first time through?
Yeah, after I get through two more, no, maybe one more. I think maybe this round is when I will have to fight all eight of the Robot Masters again. And then after that is the Wily stages, I believe. If I have this right. Oh boy.
Really not looking forward to this, are you?
I'm doing okay. I'm doing fine. It's all good.
Okay.
Okay.
Almost another $25.
Almost.
You are getting it done.
Jump, 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 jump.
Ooh.
Jump the gun. I'm going to use a save state here because I don't want to have to go through that again. I will make it through the game legitimately, I swear.
So, who is it that's your sponsor for the games? Today?
The $25 one?
Yes.
A gentleman by the name of Alex. I don't know if he wants his full name said.
Alex will work great.
Yeah.
We'd like to thank Alex.
I'd definitely like to thank Alex for having faith in me, but I have not yet proven my worth.
Oh.
Door, because I was actually one screen ahead of there. I think we've proven that I can get through that screen okay. What we haven't proven is that I can get through this screen okay.
Now, if somebody wanted they also, Skepticon, even if it's not by helping by putting out money every time a Mega Man game is beat. If you have a product that you would like, you can have that put up at a table at Skepticon. That is part of the ways that we're able to pay for the free con that everybody is able to enjoy. It's by allowing people to have a look at the different products, like the really interesting books that we see each year, because everybody wants to get the latest book. We can do that. If you have an interesting book or maybe a cause that you would like to champion, you can go to the skepticon.org /sponsors to find out about introducing the Skepticon to your cause or product that you would like to be in. If it would be something that would be appropriate. Because there's a lot of things are not appropriate.
Like religion, but or...
You never know. There was a... there's a couple of things that you go and you see at Skepticon, at least me, and I'm like... Later on, I'm like, oh. Why, it's at a skeptics convention. Like, that's the place for it. Because you get... I like going through the area just to see the causes that people want to champion. Like, the Humanist Society. They've had a booth there.
Okay.
Because I've been so new to the skeptical and atheist communities, I just did not know about it for a while. And now it's like one of my favorite causes, just because if everybody actually did that, things would be easier. Humans, for the fact that they're humans.
Yeah.
Which seems so straightforward that you wouldn't need it, but unfortunately.
I definitely consider myself more the humanist variety of atheist than... just merely saying, hey, there's no God, therefore I'm the smartest. I always found that to be very unsatisfying.
Yeah. Yes, that was something that turned me off to a lot of people that I hear talk. Because I have a hard time with that kind of attitude as well. But there is a lot of things that... unfortunately, you just kind of have to put up with somebody telling you you're wrong over and over before you realize that, oh yeah, I'm wrong.
And sometimes there are things that are more important than just you're wrong. There's like, are you being a good person to other people? I don't really know where I'm going with that, honestly.
Yeah. That is okay. Not knowing where you're going is where all of us are. But you are almost at the end, to the end of the level. So that's something.
That is a thing. I'm going to use another energy tank. Because I don't want to have to go through that again. See if I can get away with using that. It's not enough room to use the rush jet. Not rush jet. It's not rush. I don't have rush yet. Rush doesn't exist yet. I'm not going to have enough energy to use it all the way up. Nope, I got it. Okay, now crash bomb and I'm done. Haha! Alright. Almost done. Almost done. Now should be the having to fight all of the bosses again. And unfortunately I'm out of crash energy. I'm gonna have to find a place to stock up on some weapon energy at some point here. Which is impossible. It is impossible at this point.
Too bad there's not a turtle shell going down a little hill for you.
Bounce on it repeatedly and get infinite lives.
Oh yeah. Everybody's done that.
Super Mario 1 was one of my formative childhood games.
Yeah, I think a lot of us have played that, even if it wasn't our first game.
Alright, let's get going. Fight the bosses again. Figure out who's who. First is Heat Man, who is vulnerable to bubble, which I haven't been using almost at all. Oh.
I love that Heat Man is the bubble. I like that.
Yeah, it's,
it doesn't make a lot of sense, but it's pretty great.
Plus, it was called Bubble Lead. Like, the weapon name is that it's a lead bubble. I don't understand how this is... How can you shoot... I'm not even going to try to understand the physics of it, as a matter of fact. I'm just going to stop. So I'm going to save the state. Let's move on to the next guy. He is Airman, which, as I recall, I was best suited to kill with my pea shooter. Excellent. Doing pretty well so far. 2 out of 8. Woodman, who is vulnerable to a fully charged heat. One hit kill. I love that.
Ooh. You're down.
Next up is Bubble Man, who is vulnerable to... I don't remember what. Who's Bubble Man again? Crash. I don't have any crash, so I have to shoot him. It's okay, though. He's not that hard. Ugh. Well, maybe he is. There we go. He's not doing too bad. I am 4 out of 8. Who's next? Who wants some? Quickman, so he's flash, which will take off half of his life bar, and then I have to shoot him down for the rest. You can even try using boomerangs on him and see what happens. No, they bounce off of him.
Okay, when you have finished with this boss, I am going to have to leave the stream.
Okay.
I have friends coming over, so I need to go be with the humans in my house.
That
so,
sounds like a plan. I actually need to walk away shortly too, but I just saw Lauren jump onto Skype, so I'll jump her back in and get her to fill time while I run off and grab something to stuff into my maw. Some kind of snack edge. Remember that today is National Lobster Day in America, and it's very important. So,
yes,
make sure to honor that secular holiday.
A theme song made for this holiday. It's one of the few that has it. It's Rock Lobster?
Yes. That's not a rock, it's a rock lobster. Excellent.
Okay.
I thank you very much for joining me and for nerding out. I appreciate that you were able to carry the conversation when I was not. So... Thanks for coming on.
I appreciated being the Luigi to your Mario. Or
always. You can be player one next time.
Okay. See ya.
Take care. Well, let's get Lauren back on the call.
Hey! Ooh, that was loud. Even to me, that was loud. I'm so sorry.
So, guess how far I am in Mega Man 2 now?
Mostly done?
Mostly done.
Oh.
I jammed through Mega Man 2 a lot faster than number 1. I'll tell you that much.
I mean, is it because I was talking to you during the first game? I don't understand.
No, it's mostly because Mega Man 1 is a lot harder. It's a lot less precise and a lot less good. 2 just takes 1 and polishes it to an absurd degree, comparatively. So, it's a much better game. Much better game. Good times, good times.
Definitely good times.
I need to get some food into me, so I'm going to run away very, very quickly and back.
Oh, good.
So, I'm going to get you to talk some more.
How?
With your mouth. Using the face hole that does the talky thing. Alright, I will be right back.
Okay. I can handle the stream. It's not my first rodeo. JK, it's totally my first rodeo. Well, I hope you are all enjoying the mega awesome Mega Man live stream for Skepticon. If you're interested in donating or pledging, you can go to skepticon.org. That's skepticon.org. No, we are not a mecha robot. We are a conference for skeptics, freethinkers, atheists, agnostics, humanists, etc. We are held annually in November in Springfield, Missouri. This year will be November 13th. 11th, 12th, and 13th, and oh my goodness, we'll be there, we'll be around, we've got plenty of great speakers, there'll be a Skepta prom, there's going to be a tabletop gaming night, and hey, it's going to be awesome, but I'm horribly biased because I help run the organization, so, you know, like you do. Yeah, all right, well. Here I am. I heard a snorting. Is someone snorting at me? Anywho. You can only talk to yourself so long, you guys. I know I'm supposed to be entertaining you, but, yeah, I got nothing. Do some dances. Finger dancing. Yeah. Shoulder dancing. Squeaky office chair dancing. I have to wonder what kind of food is best for video game marathoning.
I'll tell you what I'm doing is I'm getting sushi.
You're getting sushi?
Hell yeah.
Okay, fancy.
Well, it's National Lobster Day, so it's important that we get some sort of lobster sushi. So I just wanted to let you know in advance that that's going to happen.
Is it really Lobster Day?
Look it up.
I'm not going to do that.
Well, there's a place called Smack Shack here that is apparently doing a $25 deal for National Lobster Day for
Snack Shack. A shack snacks.
Smack Shack.
Smack.
Yes.
Well, I'm less interested now.
Yeah, because they hit you. They smack you around. That's what they do.
LOL. No,
that's kind of awful. Ugh.
Yeah, anyway. What did you and Vaughn talk about?
I don't know, stuff. Things. He apparently had a Tandy 2000 as his first computer. My first computer was a Tandy 1000 EX, so we're Tandy kids.
That is wickedly and wildly exciting.
I know, right? Tandy was a brand of computers by Radio Shack. It was
Radio Shack!
Remember Radio Shack?
Dude, I... That final Super Bowl commercial they did about being a throwback was really, it was like probably the best commercial I'd seen in a long time, and it didn't work. I know. I don't know.
I feel bad about their disappearing into the ether the way that they
are. Right.
And you appear to have frozen. That's okay, I just beat Metal Man. That's really cute. Call dropped? Oh no! Now I've got to find Mouse.
Hello again.
Long time no talk. What the heck was that?
Hello?
Hello? Can you hear me?
Hi!
Hi.
Oh yeah, I can now.
Okay. I don't know what was going on there. What the heck was that?
I don't know. The internet connection between here and not quite Canada is not good. I don't know.
Not in Canada, I'm in Minnesota. Canadian, that doesn't make my internet connection Canadian, thank you.
It doesn't?
That's not how this works, Lauren. You know this.
Okay.
I'm about to fight Flashman, who is vulnerable to wood. You didn't see this wall. No, you're not vulnerable to wood. What the heck?
Vulnerable to wood. How many jokes can we make about this? Oh, man.
And also, his name is Flashman.
So, well, during... Oh, okay. Good.
So, you know... All the jokes have been made already for you.
They have. So why even bother? Honestly, why even bother?
Why are you here?
I don't know. Do you want company or not?
Suppose. I mean, I don't know who I'm fighting now. Wily. Yay, Wily.
There are so many bad guys named Wily, or perhaps it's the same guy.
It's the same guy.
Yeah.
The same guy in every one of these.
Right on.
That douchebag again.
Do you think they named Wily after someone they don't like? So, you know, like, now everyone will hate him.
Wily. His name is Wily.
Right. Wily.
Huh. These seem to be working better.
So, Jason, do you remember that giant body puppet dinosaur Tinkerbell?
Oh, do I? Who doesn't?
Ah, yes. They're hoping to return this year. They're trying to work out some logistics, but word on the street is that they will be returning.
Awesome. That's great.
Very awesome. That suit is so heavy. I got like, a chance to...
Heavy, heavy in the...
like, literally heavy.
Back to the Future.
Like, weight.
Like Marty McFly saying
weighs heavy. A lot of pounds.
It weighs.
It weighs things. Okay. Yes. Yeah. It's also heavy in the cool sense of the word, right? But I got a chance to peek in the body puppet, and then in the head, they've mounted like these little iPads that are attached to cameras so that whoever's wearing it can see where the heck.
Oh, I died.
Pretty awesome. Although, I tried to stand up in it and walk around, but I'm too short. I was so upset. I was like, you know, I'm a lifter. This body puppet weighs a lot, but I'm sure I can handle it. I'm going to go for it. And I brace my feet and I stand up at my full height. And I'm not even a little bit lifting it off the ground because it's meant for someone taller. It was so embarrassing.
You should be embarrassed. And your tiny arms. Tiny T-Rex arms.
I do have small hands, small arms. I've met very few people with smaller hands than me, but... I wanted to wear the Tinkerbell costume, and I couldn't because I was too short.
Oh, you poor dear.
There's no justice in the world.
The cats are fighting. What are you doing, jerks? Guys.
Cats are fighting.
One of them is singing the song of our people.
I don't know if I told you this, but I really do not like cats.
No?
No.
Why not? Did a cat kill your father?
They're evil creatures. Evil. No, a cat didn't kill my father. He's very much alive. In fact, I have to pick him up from the airport in about an hour and 20 minutes.
Oh, cool.
Yep.
And that's why you're going to be gone in an hour and 20 minutes.
Right, yes.
Because you had said that you were going to be on the stream from 10 a.m. through until... What was it? That was 6,
noon?
Actually. It's 5. An hour and 20 minutes would be 5 o'clock. Oof.
No.
No, 4 o'clock.
Things... I'm going to hang out with you for probably another 25, 30 minutes, and then I got to bounce. But I'll be back. Mm-hmm. But it's funny you should mention cats because, you know, every year at Skepticon, we have a theme, which may or may not translate to the greater public, but the team really enjoys our themes because it makes it fun, it makes organizing fun, and this year, because it's SK9, the theme is like puppies and kittens because, you know, half the team is kittens and half the team is puppies, so we had to have both.
Ugh. Really? Ugh.
I know.
I like both dogs and cats, though, so it's fine for me.
Yeah. We like the good pun, like K9, you know, SK9, good pun. So.
And also
you'll notice a lot of our dinosaur graphics, the dinos are, like, catching frisbees and getting the paper and doing, like, playing with string is the t-shirt, like a big ball of yarn.
Oh, is that what's going on there? I was wondering. I had no clue.
It's a giant ball of yarn!
Okay, I get it now. God, don't browbeat me.
I'll do what I want.
So I hear.
I mean, it seems so obvious to me. Now I'm concerned that nobody knows it's a ball of it. So the Skepticon 9 t-shirt. You can pre-order it now on our website, on our Shopify site. It's a kind of like a, I don't want to say it's a heather purple because it's darker, but it's a really beautiful purple color. It's got a teal graphic of our Apatosaurus Marie on her back kind of playing with a big ball of yarn. I'm excited about it. It looks really great.
That sounds really awesome. I like last year's because it didn't actually have the word Skepticon on it, and so I felt like I could bring it to work without people being like, Skepticon? What are you... What? But,
yeah, this year we don't have the word Skepticon on it. Well, I think we do have the word. Just of the year? God, I don't remember. Bad, Lauren. Quickly to the graphic. It does say Skepticon! No regrets.
No regrets.
Yeah.
Hashtag no filter. I like saying that in contexts that don't make any sense.
Oh, yeah, whatever. But not having Skepticon on the last 2 year shirts, I think, was a design team decision that they... I mean, yeah, it's nice to have just a beautiful shirt, but at the same time, a lot of people were like, I want people to know I got this here, not just some random dino shirt.
Yeah. So. I just have random dino shirts. What's wrong with a random dino shirt?
I know. Well, you and I are random dino shirt havers, but
right.
Who are we to tell the rest of the world what to do with or not do with their dino shirts?
Awesome. That's who we are.
Right. Right. So silly of me.
Dino shirt.
Mm-hmm.
And by awesome, I mean I'm going to keep dying repeatedly at this boss.
Oh, great. Perfect.
By the way, this is the last boss. I'm at the last boss of Mega Man 2 now.
Oh my god, that's great. We're like so close to another $25.
Yeah.
Woo! I'm going to take a minute to brag about my design team while you may or may not be beating this boss.
Sure.
Some local St. Louis, Missouri graphic designers, a design duo, they call themselves Bear and Otter Company, are doing all of the graphic work for us this year. So they've done all of the website redesign, they're doing the t-shirt and the program. And so if you like what you see and you think the graphics are super cool, they're going to have a table this year where you can stop by and tell them how much you like their work and maybe buy some of the stuff. Hey.
Maybe buy some of the stuff in AR. Huh?
At Skepticon, they will have a table there.
Okay.
Did I cut out a lot?
Yeah, you cut out a lot.
Crap. Okay. Well, I really don't know what to repeat because I don't know when to cut out.
I mean, I want to just troll you and be like, oh, just say it all from the beginning and then do that like 8 more times, but I also don't want to be that big of a jerk.
Okay.
No, so they are going to have a table and you should check out their designs.
Yes, they're going to have a table, so if you like what you've seen design-wise for Skepticon this year, then you'll like what they make at their company, and they'll have a table, and you can say hello, and give them a high five or two, or maybe some of your dollars, whatever you feel.
You feeling it? You feeling the dollars?
Mm-hmm.
All of you viewers, all of you 8 viewers who are actually watching this live, should be considering, perhaps, giving to Skepticon.
Yeah. You know, donate if you can, and if you can't, what's also helpful is just spreading the word. You know, tell your friends about us, you can tweet, Facebook, I don't know.
If you're on the Facebooks.
Are you Snapchat, the thingies, I don't know.
Snapbook your face.
Yeah, tumble the snaps. I used to be cool, 9 years ago.
I'm not sure about that, I'm skeptical.
You should be. anyway. But yeah, if you're unable, it's totally fine, totally understandable. It's also useful to help us spread the word about Skepticon, to see the live stream or any of our speakers. That is just as valuable as actual donations.
Yeah, like getting the word out is good.
Yeah.
Just by itself. It's its own good because you want people generally to be skeptical. Telling them about Skepticon is a good way to expose people to these new ideas of skepticism.
And I'm horribly biased, but I think we're the best, so, you know. Yeah. You should tell all your friends about the best.
I think
the best thing out there.
We're the best around.
Oh! Nice.
Should have had that like on a soundboard or something and start playing it.
Yeah. That or like lots of fart noises like in box speakers.
Right. You could have Gene's keyboard.
I want it so bad. I think the fart keyboard would come in handy on more than one occasion in life. Like, I can think of many uses for a fart keyboard. Many.
I can generally just think of one. Like, making a fart noise. I mean, that's...
This is what separates the wheat from the chaff, Jason.
What other uses would you have for it? Are you gonna play, like, a symphonic orchestra and fart noises?
Maybe not!
Oh, I keep dying!
Yeah. Stop dying! You have to win this game so we can get another $25 for Skepticon.
Right. You know what's badass about this is that this is supposedly like this alien creature that Wily turned into.
Oh, good.
But it's not. It's just a hologram. Just to scare you. I don't know why he created a hologram machine that would scare you. But I don't also know why a robot would be scared particularly of an alien. I don't know. I don't understand the logic of this one at all.
Because they're aliens? I don't know. I got nothing.
Oh, I wish I had saved an energy tank.
Me too! I don't know what that means.
You know, the last guest actually cared about my progress through this game.
Oh, well, the last guest is gone now. You're stuck with me.
Great. Great.
Check. Sorry, not sorry. Would we hashtag anything?
Ugh. I get the timing right for when I go underneath him.
Yes, that sounds important. Get the timing right.
We're going underneath the other guy.
Yeah! Right. Jumping
like
and
saying
stuff
something,
things.
Something dirty. But
really?
It's
oh.
It's a shame, huh?
Yeah. So just you have been like eating and drinking and taking care of yourself, right?
To an extent. I have a can of Coke over here that I have not drank from since I opened it.
Since you opened it?
Well, it was only seconds ago, but it was a minute ago. I don't know.
Oh, noes.
But tell me about taking care of yourself at conventions. Did you already talk about that? Yeah, you did.
I've mentioned it twice, but then we got distracted by other things. I know it.
Tell us about self-care.
Oh, Lord have mercy, self-care. Well, it comes... We were on and not a sprint, and really, people get con crud because they're not eating well, they're not sleeping enough, they're not hydrated at conventions, so your body just gets lambasted. So... Try to avoid those things. Get enough sleep. Drink water.
Shower once a day. That's a thing.
Right, yes. Hygiene. Washing hands, showering. Eating vegetables are good.
Yes. Yeah, don't just eat Doritos all weekend long. Speaking of which, I want some Doritos.
Speaking of which... You picked a really crunchy food to eat, like, on camera. People are gonna hate you for that.
That's true. I think people are gonna hate me for a lot of reasons. I think Doritos is just, you know, one among many.
No, I think that's the top one. I really think eating... Like, if you ate Doritos right now and I had to listen to it, I'd hang up. Straight up.
You told me to take care of myself.
But don't eat Doritos in my ear.
Alright, I suppose. I'll do you that kindness. How's that?
I appreciate that. But I think, I mean, self-care at conventions really just comes down to common sense and listening to your body. And yes, you want to stay up and stay out and party, but you're also human and you have limits and you have to accept them and respect them. Like, I would say, find
you're
the schedule for the con and pick the things you absolutely don't want to miss, and then I don't know, naps are good. Naps are great, man.
Got them.
Oh, you did it!
I did it. I did the thing. And it turns out that alien was actually just a hologram machine.
He was a hologram all along.
Ah, shocking plot twist.
That is shocking. I'm so shocked right now.
Makes a lot more sense if you saw what was going on the screen. That's okay.
You know, I can imagine it because I have an art degree and I'm like very visual, so it's fine.
Yeah. It was the scene from Die Hard with the explosions. It was that.
Yeah. Oh, that's exactly it. There's so many scenes with explosions that, like, you gotta narrow it down.
One of the ones where that guy is, like, walking away from an explosion casually while it's going on in the background.
I can't think of any walking away. There's lots of running away from explosions. And, like, diving away from them because, you know, that's what you do, right?
Right.
And you run and dive away from the explosions.
And there was, crawling on broken glass and stuff like that.
Yes. Yes.
Walking on broken glass. That scene was great. And he was just like, crunch, ah, crunch, ah, I gotta do this. Ah, this is what I'm doing right now as I'm walking across broken glass, playing all the Mega Man games for you.
Oh, really? This is that hard? Is that difficult?
No, well, they're pretty hard.
I mean, it's funny you should mention stepping on glass, because that's something I literally did whenever I hung up for a minute. I was doing laundry and I stepped on... Apparently there's just a little broken chip of glass in front of the washing machine. I don't know how that happened.
Well then, that sucks.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Turns out, stepping on actual glass really sucks.
Kind of, yes.
I'm not like John McCain tough. McClane.
McCain.
That's a senator.
John McCain is pretty tough, though.
McClane. Like, John McClane tough. I'm not... walk on glass and crawl through vents and all that stuff. Someday, maybe, but not today. Today's not that day. Oof. Oof, what?
I just drank too much of this Coke all at once.
Oh, good. Well, now that your blood sugar's up, let's talk about the blood drive.
Oh, yes, the blood drive. I try to give every year. I wasn't able to last year because I was just coming off of a cold or a flu or something.
I see.
But I try to give every year at Skepticon.
I appreciate that. Our blood drive is on Friday from 1 to 5 o'clock. They have that big van in the parking lot just outside the main venue. If you're unsure of where that is, you can ask anybody who's working in the merchandise booth. It's just out those glass doors where the food trucks usually are. And yeah, giving blood saves lives. And so we've got a bunch of people with blood on their bodies. We figured we might as well add a blood drive to Skepticon.
Yeah.
Heathens can do good things.
Well, I mean, our blood pumps just as well as a theist's blood, right?
I dare say better, Jason. I dare say it does better.
We're just a superior breed.
Yeah, that's totally...
That's not what we're about. No, we're not about smug superiority over others.
Jason.
don't tell.
No.
Secrets.
Keep it secret, keep it safe.
Okay, so I just beat Mega Man 2. We are
awesome.
Done the credits, so I'm going to get started on Mega Man 3.